Sara, this burden of celebrity that you carry even before you have a chance to find who you are, establish who you are, carve out your own personality. Not just famous parents, famous grandparents on both sides. How was that growing up?
See, I'll be honest with you. I don't, you know, people have used words like burden, pressure, all of that, but I don't really believe in that. I think that, you know, you're as burdened as you want to be. And you take as much pressure as you want to, you know. Of course, I'm aware, acutely aware, that I come from a film background and therefore the scrutiny or the attention that I have received has been more than it would be otherwise. But I don't necessarily look at that as a burden, because if I do, then I will be stiff and I won't be able to perform. And I don't think that that's fun then, you know. I think that I'm, like I said, I'm aware of where I come from, but I don't at all look at it as a burden, and I don't think I ever have.
So I think there's a part of it that's a privilege. There's a part of it that's fun. And there's part of it that must be mildly suffocating.
I see, again, suffocating is an intense word. I don't know about that, but I think that with any form of kind of, like you said, privilege.
Yeah.
There is a setback to it as well, you know. There is a lot of scrutiny. There are a lot of eyes on us, for instance. And I can't deny the fact that star children, as much as I hate those words, do get it easy, you know. We do have a privilege in terms of access that others don't have. But it also comes with scrutiny. And at the risk of sounding negative, which I don't intend to at all, because whether it's the audiences or the industry or the media, everybody has been very, very loving, maybe even more than I deserve. But I do think that there is a whole lot of people out there who are waiting for you as a star child to make one mistake.
Of course, and to
or
fall.
Or to falter even a little bit to be able to say, dekha, usko to aasani se mil gaya, usme to baat hai hi nahi. So I am also aware of that. So I don't take it again too seriously or look at it as too much of a burden. But I am aware that there are people kind of maybe even wanting us to fail.
Of course there are. There's a Schadenfreude. People like to see other people fall. And with star children, you're right, it's a horrible phrase. There's that sense of, you know, let them not succeed. Let the second generation not have.
And that always happens.
Has that happened to you? Have you had to face snideness? I know there's a certain amount of social media trolling that goes on for all of us. But beyond that, have you had to face a who does she think she is? She has it so easy.
You know, I'll be honest with you. Like I said, you know, at least the audiences in the media have given me a lot of love. I think much more than I deserve. But also, to be very fair, I'm kind of a little bit blind towards negative vibes, you know. I've never been able to get them, you know. And people are like, did you see that? She was being so mean. And I was like, really? I didn't think so. Because I just have grown to attempt to see the best in people. And when it's not possible, I go to my two best friends, which are denial and delusion. And I just live in them. And I'm like, oh, this person's great. Like, it's all good. Because I really think that that takes you much further.
But what happens when denial and delusion get busted?
Then you realize that there are these people out there, like I have sometimes when my two friends have gotten hurt, that, you know, there are people out there who are kind of, you know, even mildly resentful of what you may or may not have. And of course, I've felt that. I've felt that. I've felt that on movie sets. I've felt that at ad shoots. I've felt that during photo shoots. There is a sense of perceived entitlement, you know. So I almost feel that we don't walk around necessarily with the label of being star children as much as we carry what you perceive star children to be. You know, the minute I walk into a room, you have a perception that, oh, she's going to be entitled. Oh, she's going to be like this. Oh, she's going to be like that. And I think that is more unfair than actually even being star children.
But talk about living in this fishbowl of, you know, constant media attention, the paparazzi. You step out to go to the gym, there are photographs, they're on every Facebook page, they're on Twitter. People are asking you why you're being uncool by wearing salwar kameez, you know.
I mean, again.
As someone who wears it all the time, I think it's the best. But
it is.
But really, I mean, it is a fishbowl. There is a fishbowl effect and you're swirling around in that water and you can forget that there is a world outside of it. So how do you keep yourself real?
See, firstly, I think that I know no better, you know. Like, both my parents will talk about this, like, social media or media scrutiny and be like, you know, it's so invasive. But I mean, I've been an actor for less than a year. You know, so for me, I don't know any better. This is the world that I came into. This is the world that I started in. So I don't have anything to compare it to. And I think that, you know, even though it can get overwhelming at times, the real truth and the real fact is, if it were to stop, given the climate that we are in right now, given social media is a big thing and media attention is a big thing, if I was maybe to walk out of the gym and there were 7 photographers not taking my photograph on the reverse to, yeah, of course, it's easy to complain and be like, oh, ho, I was bloated today and they took a picture. Oh, God, I'm so sad, which happens. But imagine the reverse, which is irrespective of how you're looking, you walk out of the gym and there are 7 photographers not clicking your photograph, or 20 people not asking for selfies.
You know,
that could also be a problem.
I once asked Mr. Bachchan, senior, what is it that scares you? And he said, one day I'll walk into a restaurant and nobody will recognize me.
And that's so true and so fair.
But does that happen? Like, do you live with that apprehension?
I don't think
you're too maybe young. I mean, I don't mean to patronize you, but I'm saying you've just started out, so maybe you don't have that. Then have
I
you
don't.
Seen your parents, for example, battling
no,
that?
Both my parents have actually taught me what I've just said, which is that, yes, sometimes if we're on holiday in London, walking on the streets, and my father or my mother are stopped for a photograph, it can get a little invasive or intrusive or unnecessary. But like, they both have realized and recognized that the reverse would be even more insulting. That they've walked around, you know, Bandra all day and nobody stopped them. That's like, what? Really? You haven't seen any of my films? That's like, oh my God, you know. They almost will walk tentatively, ki koi to dekh lo yaar. Matlab, kya ho kya raha hai? You know? So that can also happen, I feel, you know.
But, you know, where is that balance in being, like, wanting that attention? Because it's professional. It's yes. What your profession needs. It's what you all live on. But not living for those cameras. And the reason I'm asking you that is that, you know, you're a young person. There must be a Sara beyond the persona. When you go to the gym, when you go out for a meal, when you go out for a drink with your friends, you don't necessarily want to be in that gaze of the camera the whole time, because you might find yourself altering your reality, your personality, your clothes.
I don't. I'm not even altering my personality here when there are so many cameras and so many people and you and me are talking and I'm assuming people are filming us and they're going to watch this somewhere else, you know. But I think that I have grown up being a very confident girl. And more than that, I've realized more than confidence, it's just easier being who you truly are.
Yeah.
Because the reverse is a lot of hard work. You know, if I was this persona that I'm not in fact all the time, and I was this, you know, other person, then that would be a huge stress to always maintain and showcase that girl. So I think I just find it easiest to be who I am. And I'll be honest with you, whether I'm talking to my friend or whether I'm in the gym or whether I'm talking to you or I'm promoting a movie, of course, the tonality of my conversation will change because I'm also aware of my surroundings. But I am who I am. And I don't think that that has ever really changed or so it doesn't become a problem for
me. So tell us about you. Tell us about you beyond what we see in Aaj Airport Pe Sara lifted her own bags. Or ye safed malmal ka kurta pehna Sara ne, or whatever. Or, you know, what we know of you from television and films, who are you? Because here's what we know about you. We know you're the daughter of Amrita and Saif. We know Amrita then, you know, you obviously share a deep bond with her, which is not to say you don't share one with your dad.
Of course. I live
but
with
she
her,
does
so
bring
different.
You up as a single parent, as
yes,
a single
she does.
Mom. You come from a multicultural, multi-religious family.
Yes.
And as I said, you have two formidable grandmothers on both sides, both Saif and Amrita's mothers were really,
yes.
were formidable women in their own right. What does that make Sara? Who is Sara?
You know, I think I'm just a young, ambitious girl that has gone to New York and studied at Columbia University.
That's my alma mater, by the way.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, wow.
Journalism school. Where did you study?
Oh, lovely. No, I mean, I did undergrad.
Oh, undergrad,
so
okay. Mm.
Not that cool. But, you know, I think, that, I mean, what do you want to know? What can I say? I think I'm just a young girl who's just has a lot of dreams and a lot of hopes and aspirations.
What do you feel strongly about? What makes you angry? What makes you mad?
Hypocrisy. I as a person, I'm not very judgmental. And I don't believe in like a universal moral code. You know, I think that you do you and she does her and he does him and I do me. And that's fine. But I think that if you stand for something, you should stand for it, period. You know, I don't like it when people have different moralities for different people, or you know, pull weight with some people but are, you know, a little more forgiving to other people. You know, that measured kind of calculative behavior changes, that really upsets me.
Mm-hmm. And how has this sort of multiculturalism of your family influenced the sum total of who Sara Ali Khan is?
I think that in general, it's made me maybe more tolerant. Also more diverse. More than I think the multicultural background, I think it's my education and my upbringing in general that's been like that. You know, we've celebrated Eid, Diwali, Christmas and Holi with equal enthusiasm at home. You know, studying abroad, one has learned to kind of respect differences, which I think is so important, especially in our industry, my industry yeah. specifically, and our world in general today, you know. People are not the same.
Yeah.
People are different, and I think that irrespective of what they stand for, they deserve, you know, appreciation and respect. And I think that coming from a multicultural background and having a slightly, you know, exposed education has made me understand that.
So you have no, you've never really had to think of religion or culture in the way that it defines your identity, because it's always been a melange, a mosaic rather.
More than that, I think that it's very intriguing to me still how these things become divisive. More, I mean, one thing, of course, it doesn't define me at all, but that's almost obvious. The fact that it becomes divisive in our world from time to time is just sad, because, I mean, they're just constructs that humans have made to kind of, I don't even know why, different reasons, but it shouldn't matter. I don't think that that has anything to do with the kind of human being that you are or the kind of treatment you receive. And the fact that that sometimes, you know, becomes an issue in our country is mm-hmm. something that I'm really not proud of.
Yeah, well said. Your years in New York, being a student at Columbia, how much of a reality check was that?
Totally.
Talk about
totally.
That.
And that's one of the reasons that I think it's extremely important for my brother, Ibrahim, and anybody really, to kind of go and get an education. It doesn't have to be abroad. It can be in our own country. There are great academic institutions in India. But I think that what it does, your education, is it gives you a certain amount of independence. You know, it's not even about what you learned. It's about the fact that you've just learned. You've gone away from home. At least for me, I'll be specific. Living in New York, to start with, nobody would recognize me, which is a huge difference, because...
And was that unnerving in the beginning?
Not at all. It was superb. It was amazing. But it's also empowering, because it lets you be you. And it lets you discover who you are external to Saif and Amrita's daughter, which is mm-hmm. something I'm so proud of and yeah. so thankful for. But there truly is more to me, you know. And I think going to New York is how I discovered that, because people didn't look at me as Saif and Amrita's daughter. They didn't know who they were or I was, mm-hmm. you know. It teaches you independence. It teaches you how to live on your own. I had an off-campus apartment, absolutely on my own. How to do the laundry, how to do the dishes, how to live alone in New York in the month of February when it's cold and depressing at 3 p.m. and you're alone, how to deal with that. So I think that being in New York has made me who I am today. I think almost everything that I know is because of those years. They were formative years of my life, and I spent them kind of discovering who I am and gaining a certain level of independence, which I think is extremely important in mm-hmm. the world that we live in today. You know, I think it helps me think even professionally better mm-hmm. because I'm more used to thinking for myself, which I don't know I would if I lived with my mom.
Sure, but you know, I'm listening to you, and I'm obviously, I can hear a young person with a mind of your own. You obviously have a few things in life you feel very strongly about. Do you believe that the media, generally speaking, compresses that personality, asks you the same 5 questions every time, are more interested in what you're wearing and who you're dating or not, than who is Sara? What is her talent defined as? What are her opinions? And does that get... Do you feel patronized?
No, I don't. I also feel like who I'm wearing or what I'm wearing is also part of who I am, you know. So I understand that there are different platforms that will cater to different questions and want to know different aspects of my personality. I think I'm a very, very different and very, very diverse person in myself. You know, I'm sitting here and having a conversation mm-hmm. with you. I know for a fact if I was sitting with a Pink Villa journalist and having a conversation, mm-hmm. the tonality would be totally different. Not to say that I would be any less Sara, you know.
So there are different dimensions of Sara.
There are different dimensions to Sara, and I don't think that, you know, anyone constricts the other. I think so long as I'm proud of who I am, which I am, and I'm honest about who I am, which I am, I don't look at it like that.
Did you always want to act?
Yes.
There was nothing else ever that you wanted to do?
Law.
Me too. Yeah. And I never got my law degree. I was too scared of failing the exam. I think we should study and take the exam together.
I'm telling you. Mm. Law and politics.
Politics?
Yes. But I don't think it's too late for that. I mean,
it's
I can join politics later.
Or law.
Please, you know, I can.
Or law. Do you think she should join politics or law? Oh.
Okay, so maybe I should join law. Right now, I'm just going to act, guys. Hopefully, y'all will continue watching my films and forgive me for not being a lawyer immediately. But I promise I will get to it.
So here's what I want to ask you. I get that you say that there are different parts of Sara and there are parts that make up the whole. Fair enough. And you are in a sort of entertainment vanity industry. So what you wear is one part of the Sara story. But as a sort of young, bright woman, do you find yourself sometimes conflicted by... You know, we were talking earlier in the day here at We the Women about the racism of skin color, how dark skin is viewed, or how if you have had weight issues, the way, and I don't mean it because you have, there were women on stage who have spoken about how they felt trapped by the image that was required of them. And I'm just wondering where Sara sees herself. When you turn the gaze on yourself, do you sometimes feel that the way women are portrayed in films is something that makes you uncomfortable? Do you feel that you have to just keep obsessing about being somebody else's image of perfect?
Again, there are two parts to this answer. One is personal, because I just think that because of the way that I've grown up and because of the parents that I've had, and I'm so thankful for that, I don't feel that way at all personally. But I am very acutely aware that a lot of women do. And I feel very strongly for them, you know. I recognize the fact that our society or our world can kind of constrict women mm-hmm. and kind of has this regressive view, worldview in which they see women. And I understand that, you know, and I see that. I'm not a personal victim of this, but I do...
You think you're not a victim of it?
I think I'm not a victim of it because my two friends, Delusion and Denial, keep making me feel otherwise. And I keep thinking that, you know, it's all good. But of course, I do understand that it is difficult for women in our country. It is difficult. It starts from home, though. You know, I don't know enough and to make, you know, big statements and try to inculcate major changes. But I know that it starts from home. I know that it starts from, please excuse me if I'm offensive, but it starts from the Punjabi mother that has favored the son over the daughter.
Yeah.
That's where it starts, you know. Or you don't have to be Punjabi. You could be anywhere and do it.
No, we're just saying that as
we're
fellow
just
Punjabi.
Saying that.
Half Punjabis.
Half Punjabis, yes. Exactly. Yeah. So I think that's where it starts from. And I think that like with most things in life, that's where the change should be initiated, if at all. I think that the way women are seen domestically, the way your mother is seen, the way your daughter is seen, the way your wife is seen, the way your sister is seen. If you, as women, more importantly, I feel, and then as men and the society in general can help change that in small nuclear units, like at home and then in your family and then in your society. I think that is the most effective way to kind of bring about any kind of change.
So talk about yourself. Have you and your brother had equal freedoms?
Again, it's different because I think that I have a progressive mother. And you can't also make the difference. See, we are not equal. Okay, we should be treated equally politically, but we are not equal.
What do you mean by that?
I can't argue that me and my brother deserve to come home at the same time. We live.
Why not?
Because maybe it's a little more dangerous for me to be
but
out on the street.
Change those.
But
I
can I?
Say a rude word. Change those people outside.
But I can't.
I mean, get them to stay in.
But can I? Or can you?
I would fight for the right of women to stay out as late as men.
I appreciate that, but I also understand and recognize the fact that I as a woman, or my mother as a woman, or my brother as a man, cannot change the intentions of the man on the road.
I know, but it's not because we are not equal, it's because the world is not equal.
Of course, but...
There's a difference, right? You see the difference. The world is not equal, we are fighting to make it equal.
I totally agree. But I don't think that it makes it, you know, a example of inequality to allow my brother to come home later than me. I think that these are just few basic things that enable safety. And I think that that's a personal choice and that's okay. But there are bigger things like political rights, so access to education or employment or equal pay. And I think in factors like this, equality is more necessary.
Talk about equal pay. Yours is an industry. I know this argument could carry on forever, so I quickly change tack. Yours is an industry that doesn't pay equally, and some women say that's not fair, and other women say we'll ask for that equal pay when we can sell movies on our own name. So which side of the debate are you?
I'm a newcomer. I mean, I'm not getting paid the amount Ranveer Singh and Varun Dhawan anytime soon anyway, so I'm not about to create any kind of personal issues here. But I don't really know. You know, I want to sound smart and I should...
hey, we just be yourself.
Let me think about this. I don't know. I don't know about this. But I think that you should be paid equally for equal amounts of work.
Yeah.
So if I had as many kicks and punches to do as Ranveer Singh did in Simba, then maybe equal pay could have been a conversation. But because he's Ranveer Singh and I was not doing as much, I seem to understand Rohit's prerogative and respect it a lot.
But there is an ageism, right? So the fact is that you're Sara Ali Khan, new entrant.
Exactly.
But there are the men who are still playing the roles that they played 20 years ago.
Yes, they are.
Like, that has to be slightly bugging.
I mean, yeah, but audiences are watching them, you know. So, I mean, you can't just blame them. I mean, audiences are wanting to watch them, like, romance the daughters of the heroines. So then great for them, man. Like, what do you want me to say? Like, I think that it's also, it's a give and take, you know. I think that we as people, yeah, can turn around and, you know, kind of criticize a question. But look at the people. I think it's also about acceptance. If we women were to put our foot down, maybe we would be treated differently, yeah? Maybe we would. I don't know. Maybe if you said, I'm bored of watching him, maybe he wouldn't be cast for the 97th time. You don't know. I don't know.
But don't you all make, like, jokes about it? Or does it make you angry?
No, I'm a newcomer. All my jokes are private.
Yeah, your answer to everything. You know your get out of jail card is I'm a newcomer.
Of course. I don't want to exploit it too soon and let everybody know, but I do it on set also. So main to nahi hu na, mujhe nahi pata. I have to go on set day after or I'm going to get caught.
But you know, I was seeing this interview you did with Anupama Chopra where you actually said something I've never heard an actor in your industry say before. And that was like, there's some days I don't feel like dressing up. Mera nahi man karta.
Haan nahi karta. But that's fine.
No, it is fine. But I thought it doesn't happen in your space.
I mean, I don't know about them, but I think it's totally normal. Especially now, I feel like there's media everywhere. And secondly, there's so many events. There's 500 awards and 3,000 red carpets and 25 people getting married and 300 festivals and, you know, different social media posts. Now, if you're going to take it all seriously, then you're not going to have fun. You need to be able to be you also. You know, I like dressing up on Diwali. But if I did that every day, then it's... Diwali every day, you know, that's no fun.
So I want to pick up a strand of something you said earlier. You said, I have not experienced that kind of regressive, oppression, as it were, in your industry. But do you feel that, again, I'll ask you, women have
I might have lied. Did I say that?
You did say that.
Say again exactly what I said.
I don't know. I didn't ratta mara your words. But your basic...
No. Some people have been regressive. I don't take it seriously. But they say stuff.
Like,
you know... tu to aurat hai, tu kyun bol rahi hai aisa?
They say this.
Yeah, yeah.
And you say?
I've heard this.
You say, I'm a newcomer, yeah. So what do you really say?
You know, honestly, I really feel like I ignore these things. Because I think the best thing to do when somebody is trying to take away your agency is give yourself multifold agency by ignoring it and being you anyway. It's not about getting into like a banter of, nahi, main aurat hu, main karungi. To karo na, chup chap se karo. जब कुछ करना होता है तो नारे लगा के करने की जरूरत नहीं है आप चुपचाप भी कर सकते हो which is what I've realized you know in life I find it best but a lot of people have said now actually I'm thinking of anecdotes and I'm finding it funny you know like on small little things like the way women dress
yeah
you know like nahi lekin tu to aurat hai are so what Well, who wants to see men's legs anyway? I mean, come on, let's be serious, you know? So, like, yeah, there are these kind of comments that one does hear. But I think the reason I might have said my overtly optimistic thing that I did earlier, yes, answer, is because I don't let it affect me. So it almost is as though it doesn't happen. But of course it does.
Yeah, and know? I was just saying that even in terms of body image, like we have all these conversations about body positivity now, does it really work, or are women still battling some guy's idea of what beautiful is?
No, I'm sure they are. I'm sure they are. I think that they do. And I think that it's not just guys. I honestly feel that women should be women's best friends. But unfortunately, in the world that we live in, it's really not that way. I think it's the woman that will first say, "Arre, look at her, she's looking so fat. Arre, she's looking so bloated." I don't even think men notice this stuff, you know, a lot of times. So I think it's this whole agenda of, like, kind of, you know, adhering to this perfect image, when I don't even know who came up with it. Like, who decides what's perfect? I mean, if you want to be a little larger than what, you know, the neighbor's wife thinks you should be, then you be that. Just be healthy, because I think that's important. But the rest is your choice and should be, always.
This was a little bit of a struggle for you.
It still is.
And do you not at some point say, you know, at some point say, I want to eat this, so I will.
See, so today I was coming to Bangalore from Bombay on the Indigo flight.
Did you eat or not? Have we starved you?
So that cart, they always have this banana chips here. That's a huge problem. So, you know, but like, I mean, I'm shooting, so I didn't eat it.
What?
Yeah. But what an uninspiring story, no? Like, imagine if I'd said, and you know, I opened the packet and I ate it, because you only live once and all women go eat banana chips. But I didn't. I didn't eat it, guys. But I'm going back to Bombay, so now let's see. Maybe now I'll inspire myself to eat some banana chips.
Can we pack you a burger and fries with some banana chips? Would
you
eat that?
Yeah, man. Just, no, I'll have a bite.
Okay, there's a serious question there. Be healthy, yeah.
Yeah.
But this constant, it disturbs me, because I've seen women actually breaking down over it. Yeah. You know, you have everything from anorexia to bulimia, eating disorders,
yes,
obsessing with not being beautiful, not being attractive, constantly living for somebody else's idea of you. Have you struggled with that?
I think so. Of course, I was very, very large. I was like 96 kgs, and of course I needed to lose weight for important reasons, because I had PCOD, I still do. And I think that it was important for me to kind of get in shape, also because it's like, you know, keeps you healthier, and that's important. But yeah, of course, there are moments, whether it's those trolls on social media, or it's, you know, bigger people, there is a pressure to look or be a certain way that is very palpable and very there.
And did it hit your confidence when you're not ticking those boxes, or when you did not tick those boxes, did it hit your sense of self?
I think that because I was as fat as I was for as long as I was, I have grown up, I don't know how much of my two friends' denial and delusion have helped me, but I have grown up kind of deriving my confidence not from the way that I look.
Yeah.
But now, because a large part of my profession, and you know, even commercially, depends on the way that I look, yes, there is a little bit of pressure. And yes, it does get nerve-wracking. And of course, it can affect your confidence. You know, you read like rude comments, or people will say stuff, and it can pull you down.
That's horrible, right?
It is horrible. It is horrible. So you need to kind of remind yourself from time to time that you are the only person that truly has the agency to make yourself feel the way that you should. And, you know, people will say what they have to say. And there comes a point where, yes, like you said, and like we were talking about like a couple of minutes earlier in a different context, that's not my problem, that's your problem.
Yeah.
But in a slightly more realistic tonality, I can't change that. I can't change the fact that you're going to pressurize me. In an ideal world, yes, all of you should be okay with all shapes and sizes, but maybe you're not. Hmm. So the second best alternative, and the much more realistic alternative, is to really tune it out and know for yourself what works, and not pay heed to other people trying to bring
and
you down.
And eat the goddamn banana chips.
And I'm going to eat the banana chips on the flight back.
Okay, I'm going to take a few questions from the floor, so make them questions, and let's not be like, you know, just offering our own opinions on banana chips or anything else. I have to ask you one thing. You've constantly said, oh, we're not a normal family. We're really odd. Have you seen us? We're really odd. And I think this audience deserves to hear the story of the parrot.
Oh, my God. My mom's parrot?
Yes, please.
My mom, okay. So, my mom likes animals. What does that mean? That she has a puppy, right? Yes, she does. But it means more. She also has a turtle, which is cute because, you know, it's just a turtle. Is that legal? Am I allowed to say this?
Just say it. Nothing will happen.
Oh my God. What if somebody comes and takes Mr. T away? Oh my God. Have I made a mistake?
No. Just carry on quickly, okay. Forget what you said.
Okay, never mind. Just don't take the turtle away, okay? We love her and we feed her and stuff. Mom loves her and feeds her. Anyway, and so Mom also had a cockatoo, actually. And the cockatoo would sit on her shoulder. So people would come for meetings and narrations. And the cockatoo would be there on her shoulder the whole time doing kah, kah, kah. And then we had to give her away back to where she came from, because she
Do you think she or you lost a few films because of the cane?
I really think so. Because like I said, you know, being an animal lover, you like dogs, it's one thing. But then you come home and you have like this bird like flying around and this turtle like under your feet. It can get a bit like weird, you know. And they're just like, what is this? Is it like a zoo? And like you get to like talk to me and my mom, and like I've said before without giving enough examples, but we are strange in our own way.
What's the strangest thing about your family?
No, how do I answer that? I mean, the fact that I don't have an answer should be indicative.
No, come on.
Like what? Ask me a more pointed question. I don't know.
When you say you're strange, do you mean that you're all quirky, eccentric?
Yeah, we are quirky. Like Mom will just come into the room and like have a joke that she won't even share and just be laughing the whole time. And I'll be like, okay, but can you tell me also? And then it'll be something really like not funny. You know, and I'll be like, okay, so this was the joke. Like, I think the joke's on you, Mom, and you're cracking it. So, you know, like, little things like that. I think it's always just like a house full with just me and my mom. I think if you just, like, bugged the room and had a camera, we would never have to work for money again. We'd just sell the footage and we'd be fine.
There's an idea there. Okay, let's take a few questions. We're almost at the end. Yes, young man here in the front row. Where are the mics? Mics, come on.
Hello.
No, wait. Wait, I'm calling the questions here. Yes.
Yeah. Good evening, Sara.
Good evening.
How were the days when your debut film, Kedarnath, got delayed for producer's use? How did you cope up that pressure?
You know, sir, I'll be honest with you. That was one of the hardest times in my life. I remember it was in February that I got a call wherein I wasn't sure. Do you want me to stand?
No. Wherein, I'm standing just to spot the audience better. But you go
and
ahead.
I wasn't sure. Forget that it was just getting delayed, you know. Our producers had kind of walked out. I didn't even know if the film would release. And we'd already shot so much more than half of it. I didn't know if I was coming or going. I mean, everything that I'd worked for, it was the lowest point of time in my life. I mean, even thinking about it gives me shivers. It was not fun.
Okay, question there.
Hi, Sara. Yeah.
There, that's
yes.
it.
Hi.
It's a dream for everyone to come out of the Ivy League of colleges, as you've done. So you've been the product of that league. So if you wouldn't have been, how would that made a different person now?
I think totally. While I'm very, very appreciative and proud of the fact that it's an Ivy League that I've graduated from, I think, and even more broadly, exposure. I think it just enables you to look at the world a certain way, and it enables you to learn how to think. You know, it's not even, you can study history, you can study geography, you can study math. I don't even think that's what it's about, or anywhere. I think it's about just your brain is a muscle that you need to learn how to use, you know. So I think studying in a competitive institution like Columbia got me to work this muscle and also geared me up for competition, which is kind of very prevalent in my industry. So
okay, last question. We're out of time. Yeah.
Hi.
Speak into the mic.
Hi, I'm Preksha Tyagi. Firstly, it's amazing to be talking to you because you're my idol and inspiration.
Thank you.
I started wearing kurtas because of you. So my question is, what would you change about the Bollywood industry in terms of empowering women?
I don't think there's anything to change in the industry per se. I think that, you know, whether we look at Padmavat or whether we look at Razi, there are a lot of films being made driven by women. I just, you know, urge more and more audiences to go and watch these kind of films so that it motivates the people behind, like the producers and the distributors and then the actors, to be able to go and do films like that. If you watch it, we'll more than happily do them, I hope.
Okay, I'm going to try and squeeze in one last question there. One or two, maybe more questions. Yeah, just stand up. Okay. Her and then you. We'll take two more, yeah.
Hi, good evening, Barkha, and good evening, Sara.
Good evening.
I'm a great fan of both of you. So in the morning or afternoon, we had a session, a fair and lovely session.
Yeah.
And there were many girls who talked about how their tan or their color has made them suffer. So any time do you fantasize about being tanned, or you want to go on beaches and get tanned? Does that color?
I love going on beaches. It has nothing to do with being tanned, but I mean, I love the beach. And I don't necessarily think that, I mean, if you want to be tanned, just put some bronzer. If you want to be fair, put some powder. I don't think it's the end of the world, but I don't think it should define you at all, you know. I think this whole chatter about skin color is like really, you know, I mean, I wanted to put pink nail polish, I put it. If I want to look dark, I'll just spray paint myself. It's fine, you know.
But what about people who are dark and are under enormous pressure to look fair?
This, again, what is pressure? I think that at the end of the day...
Prejudice, rude comments...
I understand that.
But bias, shaadi nahi hogi.
Lekin aap badloge nahi. Main bol sakti hu ki sabko bolna chahiye ki sab sundarta ek hi hoti hai. Lekin shayad nahi bolenge yaar. Lekin aapko hona chahiye na. Aapke andar wo confidence honi chahiye ki jo bolna hai bolo.
Hona chahiye, lekin sab mein nahi hota.
Lekin... main ye manti hu that there is a larger probability and a higher success rate for you to attempt to change yourself than to change the world, because they are not going to change.
Okay, very last question. Very last question, yes.
Hi Sara, I wanted to ask you that how come you are so cute?
Cuteness lies in the eyes of the beholder. So your very cute eyes are finding me cute. So thank you very, very much for that lovely compliment.
Okay, here's the thing. I want to call on stage.
I'll stand.
You please do stand. One of our younger producers, because selfies are a thing in your generation.
Yeah,
right?
They are.
So we had everybody pitching for who gets to take a selfie with Sara. And oh, we know lovely. We can't get that happen outside. So we're going to call Prashanti on stage. She's the lucky one today, who gets to have all of you and Sara in a selfie. But before that, I would like to honor you with our award. It's called the Her Award. Hope, Empower, Rise, for having the spunk to be yourself, and wishing you much, much success ahead. Let's have a big round of applause for the cute and the very cute, but that I'd like to use a better word, for being herself and for having fierceness of spirit. A huge round of applause for Sara Ali Khan. Come on, better than that.
And, thank you.
And now
wait.
All of you and that selfie. Come on. Guys, get ready, all of you, okay? Okay, are we getting everyone?
Yeah.
Okay. Got it? Got it? Thank you so much. Thank you.